Okay, so this time, this is really a one-off lecture. I want to talk about cold atoms in optical lattices. Now, obviously, this is an interesting subject in its own right, but since this is the Institute for Quantum Computing, I thought that what you'd probably be mostly interested in is why people think that these cold atom in optical lattice systems might be useful in the context of quantum information and quantum computing. So basically, I'll talk about two applications, well, three really. One is to quantum simulation of existing condensed matter systems. One is to quantum computation of the sort of traditional type. And then the third will be a brief application to possible topological quantum computation. So let's start by saying, topological. Okay, well, we have to, try to explain that. Let me get that. Okay, so what are we talking about here? Generally speaking, I mean, people, in recent years, people have started playing about with more complicated things like molecules, but mostly we're talking about a monatomic gas of atoms, which have, at least in the past, usually been alkali atoms, although there are now several experiments which go beyond that. And the sort of atoms which are typical in these experiments are rubidium 87 and sodium 23. And you remember that the alkalis have an odd number of electrons, and therefore these isotopes are bosons. In fact, they have an even total number of fermions. These guys, by contrast, potassium 40 and lithium 6, are fermions. Incidentally, potassium 40 is weakly radioactive, and I don't know if you know, but the main source of radioactivity in your body is actually potassium 40. Luckily, it's not very radioactive, and so that doesn't really screw up the experiments too much. The states usually used in the context of quantum computation and related things are usually in the electronic ground state manifold. So that's NS, that is, you have a set of closed shells, and then you have one extra electron in the S state outside that. Now, of course, the ground state is itself somewhat degenerate, or at least at first sight it's degenerate, but it'll be split by the hyperfine interaction, since all these isotopes have non-zero nuclear spin. And in addition, it'll be split by any external magnetic field. Now, in general, of course, the system can relax between these different hyperfine Zeeman states within the ground state manifold. However, there are always two states which are specially stable. For example, for rubidium 87 or for sodium 23, both of which have I equals 3 halves, then it turns out that the F equals 2, MF equals 2, and the F equals 1, MF equals minus 1 states are both specially stable. They're sometimes called stretched states. What's the hyperfine interaction? It's the interaction between the spin and orbital magnetic moment of an electron and the spin of the nucleus. In non-topological quantum computation, these are usually used as, this should be actually computational, as the computational basis here. Okay, so a crucial point about these atoms are, of course, that they can interact with the radiation field, and it's this interaction with the electromagnetic radiation field, usually provided by various lasers, which is the universal means of manipulating the atoms. In the electric dipole approximation, which is usually very good for the alkalis, the interaction Hamiltonian is simply the electric dipole moment times the electric field and the electric field of the laser, and that couples the ground state overwhelmingly to the NP manifold. So you get a very strong transition between the NS and NP states and very little to any higher states. An essential point to appreciate, that except in the very smallest fields, which are rarely used in practice, the line width of the states of both the NS and the NP manifold are very small compared to the... I shouldn't have said that. Of course, the NS state, since it's the ground state, does not have any kind of electronic relaxation. So, but the line width of the electronic states of the NP manifold, very small compared to the Zeeman hyperfine splitting of either of these two manifolds. And what that means, that's a huge advantage, because that means that by appropriate tuning of your laser, you can selectively address the individual Zeeman and hyperfine states. And that's going to be absolutely essential in the applications. So the general principle of optical trapping goes something like this. Let's, for the moment, just assume you had one state in the NS manifold and one state in the NP manifold, just for simplicity. Of course, we don't, but we have to get back to that. But let's assume we did. So if the frequency of the radiation is close to the NSNP resonance, then effectively you polarize your atom and thereby induce an energy shift in the ground state. And the energy shift is given by this expression here. And so you see that this can be written as the intensity of the radiation field, E squared, times some factor which we just call I zero, times the line width, gamma squared, divided by delta. I is defined so that it has a factor of gamma squared in it, and so this does in fact come out. But the important point to notice here is that that apart from this factor, which is just a constant for any particular transition, the delta E is proportional to gamma squared over delta. And delta here is an important quantity. It's the detuning of the radiation relative to the... The detuning should refer to this whole expression here, okay? So it's the difference between the energy of the photon and the energy difference of the two levels, okay? So when you are tuned slightly below the transition, it turns out that this is an attractive, this energy is negative, so you get an attraction, if you like. When you're tuned above the transition, then you get a repulsion. Spontaneous emission of real photons is, of course, a problem here, but that turns out to go as gamma cubed over delta squared. So if you take I large compared to this saturation intensity, but nevertheless delta much greater than gamma, that is, you tune outside the natural line width of your state by a large margin, then you can get substantial trapping with very little spontaneous emission. That's what's usually done in the experiments. in fact, it's usually quite easy to achieve a fairly large energy shift due to the radiation interaction with negligible spontaneous emission. What does relatively large mean here? Well, the usual units in which people tend to work in this area is the recoil energy, which, as its name implies, simply means that the energy which an atom experiences when it emits a photon and as a result recoils. And that's usually a rather small quantity. Typically, for rubidium-87, for example, it's about 200 nanok. So this is a sort of characteristic energy in which one usually measures energies in the optical lattice system. So let me just emphasize... Let's just go on for one more slide, and then we can do this. So let's consider a pair of laser beams which have a wave vector k1, k2, and a frequency, appropriate frequency, omega 1 equals ck1, etc. And suppose that the difference between the frequencies is small compared to either separately. So your electric field is of this form here. The intensity is the square of the electric field. So let's look at that. Let's take the special case where the two fields have equal strength. Then what you find is that the total electric field can be written in the form of a fast oscillating term multiplied by this rather more slowly oscillating term. And let's assume that the frequency difference is small compared to the natural line width. And that limit, that's certainly enough. It's not a necessary condition, but it's certainly a sufficient one to take the detuning to be approximately the same for the two. In this case, after we've averaged over the optical potential, what we find is this expression here. And in particular, if we make the special choice that K1 is exactly equal to minus K2, that is, you have two counterpropagating laser beams, that's something which is pretty easy to rig up simply by having a mirror and reflecting one of the beams, then you find that in that case delta omega is zero, so you get v of x is equal to this. Let me emphasize that's because you averaged over the fast oscillations here. The fast oscillations are typically on a scale of optical frequencies, 10 to the 16th seconds to the minus 1, say. It's a very, very short time scale in the context of optical lattices. So you simply average over that, and you end up with this expression here. There's no reason why you just stick to one pair of counterpropagating laser beams. You can have three mutually counterpropagating beams, so, okay? And in this way, you get a nice... we actually get a nice perfect periodic potential. Okay. So emphasize again, if you red detune your laser, that is, you tune to so that the frequency of your laser is slightly less than the frequency of the real atomic transition, then you get an attractive potential. If you tune oppositely, you get a repulsive one. So you can do either, but in either case, you can create a perfect lattice of this type. Okay, so you get essentially you get this rather nice periodic potential. But remember, it's actually in three dimensions. The height of the potential typically in experiments is anything from about 0.1 to 20 times the recoil energy. Remember, that's the conventional unit for discussing things here. And the wavelength is a half of the original laser wavelength. That's basically because of the interference of the counterpropagating beams. Now, that's the case when you're... When you have exactly counter-propagating beams. If you want to have a larger wavelength than that, you can do it by inclining your beams relative to one another. You can easily work out the geometry of that. However, it's impossible using these techniques to make the period smaller than lambda over 2. So you're basically stuck with that. And that's actually quite important when you're thinking about orders of magnitude of various energies in the ultra-cold lattice system.
Do they neglect gravity?
No, that's a very good point. In cold atom, ultra-cold atom physics, gravity is a very important effect. And in fact, you can do all sorts of cute experiments in which you actually bounce atoms like billiard balls in the Earth's gravitational field and so forth. Yes, it's very important. It's very important when you're discussing a particular experiment to know which way the apparatus was oriented. In fact, it does make a difference. Now, there's one slight complication, which is a nuisance, but we have to take it into account. You've got to, in some sense, you've got to have been able to trap your atoms in the first place in a restricted region of space. So, crudely speaking, unless you're very, very clever, what that means is you have to have some kind of harmonic trap as a background to your optical potential. This could be your background trap could either be itself a laser potential or, more commonly, a magnetic potential. But in either case, it does form a sort of smooth, continuous background. And when you're discussing real experiments, you have to always bear that in mind. So what you typically, the way that experiments work is that they first start off with just, let us say, a magnetic harmonic trap, and then they do some kind of evaporative cooling or something of that kind. In that way, they produce a rather high, well, high by atomic physics standards, a high density of atoms in the centre of the trap, and having done that, they then erect the lattice potential. Okay. And one advantage of that is that in the absence of the optical lattice, you can typically achieve densities of the order of 10 to the 12 and 10 to the 15 atoms per cubic centimetre. Now, of course, that's, by ordinary standards, that's really not very high. Anyone know what the density of the air in this room is? Something more like 10 to the 18 or thereabout. So it's several times, several orders of magnitude times this. So by ordinary standards, this is a very dilute system, but it's dense enough for our purposes. And since the cell dimension is the order of 300 nanometers, you can see that it's easy to trap of order one or greater atoms per site. So that's another nice feature about these ultra-cold atoms. If you want to get one or more atoms per lattice site, it's fairly straightforward. Okay, so now let's talk a bit about the energies of atoms sitting in an optical lattice. And now I'm going to be talking about the actual energies associated with the spatial motion. So remember that we're, generally speaking, talking about a single hyperfine atom in a single hyperfine state. Well, near the bottom of each well, each potential is nearly harmonic, so you can work out the classical small oscillation frequency, and if you do the appropriate bit of algebra, it turns out that divided, that the ratio of the barrier height to the zero point energy is V0 divided by E recoil to the half. That's one of the reasons why this E recoil is a nice thing to work with as a useful convention here. So when V0 is much less than the recoil energy, then this is also small compared to 1, and that means then that the barrier is actually only of the order of the zero point energy. In that limit, the atom moves nearly freely, and the optical potential is just a small corrugation, small perturbation. On the other hand, when V0 is much greater than the recoil energy, then this factor is fairly large. The atom is tightly bound in individual wells, and this picture here roughly applies. The zero-point width, again, divided by the lattice spacing, if we divide that by the lattice spacing, that ratio is again proportional to ER divided by V0 to the 1/4 power. So generally speaking, provided that the barrier height is large compared to the recoil energy, which is typically the case in most experiments, then the atoms are going to be sitting close to the bottom of the well here, and the zero-point spread is going to be small compared to the actual width of the well. That means that's a rather straightforward case to analyse. Next energy we have to consider is the, after the zero point energy, is the tunnelling energy. In the tight binding limit, you can have a simple expression for the tunnelling matrix element between neighbouring potential wells. You know, it has this standard WKB type expression. There's some constant here, a numerical factor. The attempt frequency, which crudely speaking is the zero-point vibration frequency, multiplied by this famous WKB factor, exponential minus alpha. And alpha, well, it's this integral here, and do the algebra, it turns out to be, again, given by V0 divided by ER. So you again see just about everything is being expressed in terms of this ratio of the barrier height to the recoil energy. So important point to emphasize here is that this tunneling matrix element is actually exponentially sensitive to the barrier height. So by making a relatively small adjustment in the barrier height, then you can change this by an order of magnitude. It's very useful. The third energy we have to be concerned with is the interaction energy. Suppose that we try to put two atoms in the same lattice site. No reason we shouldn't. Now, Of course, we can only do that if they're either bosons or if they're fermions in a spin singlet state. I say a quote spin singlet state. What I mean by that is that we may be able to take our two computational states, say, the specially stable states of our Fermi system, and put one atom in one and one in the other. If we try to put both the fermions in the same spin state, then the Pauli principle forbids us to put them both close to the same lattice side. Anyway, given that, at low energies, there's a rather general result that the interaction between two bosons in the same state, or between two fermions in a spin singlet state, is given by this expression here, where A sub S is the two-body scattering length, which is something that you can actually measure by various optical techniques. And so for most purposes, so long as we really are dealing with ultra-cold atoms, and this is independent of whether we have a lattice or just an extended state, if we're at sufficiently low energies and sufficiently dilute, then this so-called pseudo-potential, this effective potential, is usually good enough for most purposes, considering the interactions. So let's apply that to two particles in the same well, and then we find that this gives us an interaction energy which is given by the integral of the density squared. I've got to be able to do is to find two particles on top of one another. So that involves the wave function squared in each case. So density squared, the wave function to the fourth. And you can do that that calculation straightforwardly. And that's, again, depends on the barrier height divided by the recoil energy, but only to the power law extent. The crucial point to emphasize, then, is that provided that AS is much less, the S-wave scattering length is small compared to the zero-point energy, which is usually the case in practice. And now, I'm sorry, this is wrong. This is a typo. This should be V0 much greater than ER here. Okay. If that's true, then both these energies, U, that's the interaction energy, and the tunneling energy, they're both small compared to the zero-point energy and the barrier height. Nevertheless, one can adjust their ratio to be completely arbitrary within this limit. So what that means then is that it's perfectly legitimate to assume that my atoms are always sitting in the ground state in the quasi-harmonic oscillator well, each well separately. Okay, so the picture is then they're always in this in the ground state, but then hop from the ground state in one well to the ground state in the other. When they sit in the same well, they have an interaction energy U. Well, we're talking here, we're usually talking about neutral atoms. So there should be no long-range Coulomb interaction between them. Now, however, you mentioned van der Waals, and yes, indeed, there is. How did we, let's just go back for a moment and ask how we got this expression here. Well, crudely speaking, the actual, if I really look in detail at how the interaction energy between two atoms depends on the distance between them, is pretty complicated. At short distances, I have a very strong hardcore repulsion. I then have some kind of essentially chemical attraction at distances of the order of maybe a couple of angstroms. When I go to larger distances, sure, I get the van der Waals potential. Now, generally speaking, if I'm dealing with atoms suppose I'm dealing with collisions of atoms which are moving in free space and moreover are very slow because they're at the kind of low temperatures. Where, incidentally, I didn't say anything yet really in detail about the temperatures. What kind of temperatures are we talking about here? Well, typically of the order of the recoil energy or smaller. So in other words, of the order of tens or hundreds of nano-K. It's really pretty slow, okay? They're pretty slow atoms. So most of the time, of course, the atoms are moving completely freely. They don't know about one another's existence. Just occasionally, they'll get close to one another, and then they have a sort of dizzying experience for a few microseconds or whatever when they interact very strongly. And they'll feel the hard core, they'll feel the attractive potential, they'll feel the van der Waals tail, and so forth. But one can show, as this is a relatively straightforward result in atomic physics, one can show that provided all you're ever going to be interested in is the properties of the scattering of these low-energy atoms and the effect it has on their energies, then you can replace your real potential by this expression here, where A sub S is something that, I mean, it's a property of the wave function, of the atom-atom wave function, which you can actually measure by various techniques, photo association and so forth.
Just one more thing. I thought that laser kind of polarized the atoms.
Ah, very good point. That's a very good point. Yes, in principle, you do get that effect, and in fact, it can even be useful on occasion. I think I'm correct in saying, though I don't do this in my head, I need to check it, but I think I'm correct in saying that under most circumstances, that is most typical laser strength and so forth, that energy is going to be considerably smaller than the magnetic dipole-dipole interaction, which is something which we will have to take into account. Okay, so those are the sort of typical energies which we have. And so from now on, I'm going to basically assume that this picture is correct, that is that we're only interested in the ground state in each individual cell, okay? And as I say, the atoms can tunnel between these ground states, and they can if two of them are in the same cell, they can interact. And that's basically the picture we're going to be playing around with. Okay, so the first application then is to try to implement the so-called Hubbard model. What does this mean? Well, in this low energy, in this limit where T and U are both small compared to the ground state energy, zero point energy and the barrier height, but we regard this ratio as arbitrary, you can write down a low energy effective interaction for a single hyperfine species, and it will reduce to this expression here. As actually, this is not quite right. There should be another term but it's essentially a constant for our purposes, so we don't need to worry about it. Now, for fermions, this is actually a rather trivial situation because for a single hyperfine species, the only possibility now is to have one fermion, to have not more than one fermion per side. Remember, so we have a single species, we can't put two fermions on the same side. So that's actually fairly trivial. However, for bosons, it's somewhat non-trivial because I can put more than one atom on the same side. And in fact, if I take bosons in a single hyperfine species, then I realize the so-called Bose-Hubbard Hamiltonian. This is not something which is, as it were, traditional in condensed matter physics. It's really only been investigated in any detail following the actual realization of optical lattices for cold atoms. It does have some very interesting properties because basically you've got a competition between the tunneling term, which is trying to delocalize the atoms over all sites, and the interaction term, which will try to reduce. If U is positive, which is the case most normally considered, then it'll try to reduce double occupation and so forth. And those two are clearly in some sense competitive with one another, those two effects. And what we find... okay, good point. The ideal ground state, if I only had this term, in fact, and could forget about this term, then what I would find is that I get BEC in the lowest block wave state. Okay? In other words, all the atoms would be equally distributed between all the lattice points. But if that's the case, then clearly there's a non-zero probability that you have two atoms on the same side. This term doesn't like that. In fact, if this term is large compared to the other one, then what you get is a Mott insulator in which you simply get, in the case where the number of atoms is equal to the number of sites, you simply get one atom per site. And so there have been a lot of theoretical studies of the transition between these two states and also a lot of nice experimental studies. And what is very nice about I hadn't put this on the slide, but one thing which is very nice about these ultra-cold atomic systems is that you can basically tweak the parameters of your model almost instantaneously. If you're trying to play, traditional condensed matter physics, when you're playing around with something, say, like liquid helium, it's incredibly difficult to do anything to the system on a time scale which is comparable to the sort of intrinsic natural time scales. I mean, the natural time scales in something like liquid helium might be, say, of the order of a nanosecond. You're just not going to be able to adjust your external parameters, like the pressure and so forth, over that kind of time scale. In some sense, these traditional condensed matter systems are very unwieldy from that point of view. Now, in the case of ultra-cold atoms, the typical time scales for this kind of situation, at least, well, they're crudely of the order of one of these energies, U or T. And that's of the order of nano K or so, which is a few hundred hertz or inverse of 100 kilohertz. Okay, so now how fast can you adjust your potentials? Well, remember that you're doing this with lasers. You know, adjust your laser basically over a microsecond or less. So you, as it were, win by many orders of magnitude here. And some of the nicest experiments, in fact, have exploited that fact. Okay, more in some sense, an application which is much closer to traditional condensed matter physics is the original Hubbard model, which had to do with fermions. Hubbard was interested in various problems in metal physics, including various magnetic transitions, and he pointed out that under certain circumstances, you might be able to catch the essentials of what was going on in a metal physics problem by writing down a model Hamiltonian, which looks like this. Again, it contains a hopping term. An atom can hop from one lattice site to the next, but you have two possible spin states involved here, and clearly the spin is conserved during the hopping process. You would expect that if I try to put if I try to put two atoms in the same spin state on the same site, I can't because they're fermions. But I can put them on if they're opposite spins, and then I would expect an interaction which, crudely speaking, I would expect to be repulsive. I'd expect a term of this type. Now this is actually, as Praja was pointing out, this is not by any means the exact Hamiltonian of the electrons in a real metal. However, Hubbard argued, and a lot of people have followed him in this, that it should capture at least a lot of the physics of so-called strongly correlated electron systems. So it has been very, very widely studied in the theoretical literature. What do we know about the solutions? Well, not an awful lot. I say not an awful lot. In one dimension, we know quite a lot, but that really isn't terribly helpful because we're much more likely to be interested in three or possibly two-dimensional systems. In three dimensions, in the limit where U over T is very large compared to one, the ground state manifold is a Mott insulator. In other words, if I have exactly the same number of electrons as I do lattice sites, then I have to just put one electron on each site. However, that still leaves the spin degree of freedom floating around. And it turns out that if I now consider the tunneling as a weak perturbation, that gives rise to a nearest neighbor antiferromagnetic coupling here. And this coupling is usually denoted in J. It's given by 4T squared over U, and since T is supposed to be much less than U, that means that this is small compared to T. This is a very small energy scale. And that result, I think, is fairly firm. But it's just about the only one which really is firm. Well, again, in the extreme limit where U is very small compared to T, then presumably your ground state is something like a Fermi liquid with small corrections to it. But anywhere in between, it's not terribly well known what happens, and people have to try to do computational solutions. One of the interesting points about the Hubbard model, one reason people are so interested in it these days, is that it is widely used as a model of cuprate superconductivity. So if that's right, that clearly raises the question, do you expect that in a two-dimensional system, remember the cuprates are for most purposes, essentially two-dimensional. So you have a two-dimensional system, which is, just suppose it were described by the Hubbard model. We know it isn't really. I mean, we know the cuprates are not really described by the exactly by this Hamiltonian, but let's suppose this is a reasonable approximation. Okay, can we then say anything about whether at zero temperature we'll get a superconducting state, whether we'll get a magnetic various kinds of magnetic transition, and so on and so forth? Well, people have tried to do this by numerical computation, but the difficulty, of course, of doing these computations rises exponentially with the number of particles. So I think right now the most people can get to is about 10 by 10, and it's often argued that's not enough to approach the real thermodynamic limit. But in any case, what we'd like to do is to see if one couldn't somehow use, instead of doing a digital computation, how about trying to do an analog computation using these atoms in ultra-cold atoms in optical lattices? What we need is two fermionic species subject with the same trapping potential, which is actually automatic if we have the simple situation of counter-propagating laser beams. So what would ideally like to do is to cool your atoms down to a sufficiently low temperature, put them in this optical lattice and see how they behave, in particular see if there are ways of trying to determine whether they're forming some kind of super paired, Cooper paired state or whatever. Now, you're right. It's highly non-trivial to assume that you can read off from the behavior of your ultra-cold atoms the behavior of real-life cuprates. However, what's interesting is that the difficulty does not come at the stage where you are describing your ultra-cold atoms by the Hubbard model. It turns all considerations which people have looked at point to the fact the Hubbard model is actually an excellent description of the ultra-cold atoms. Whether it's an equally good description of the cuprates is a quite different matter. Okay? So the best one can do really is to ask the question, does the Hubbard model give us superconductivity in two dimensions? Now, okay, so why aren't people rushing off to do this? Why do we not already have, after all, ultra-cold atoms have been around for 16, 17 years, and even fermion ultra-cold atoms have been around for quite a few years. So why have people not solved this problem? Why, why don't we know the answer to the question, does the Hubbard model give us superconductivity in two dimensions? And the problem, I think there's something missing here, but the practical problem is that to see anything interesting, even the simple antiferromagnetic transition, you need actually temperatures comparable to this J, which occurred in my previous expression. And remember, that was much smaller than T, which was already itself very small. So you need very, very low temperatures, typically of the order of pico degrees. The usual technique is to first cool in a pure harmonic trap, and then you can actually reach temperatures which at least are low compared to the Fermi temperature, typically of the order of down to about 0.05 of the Fermi temperature, I guess. And then you try to switch on your optical lattice. But alas, very often you find that switching is not adiabatic as you'd like it to be. And so far, therefore, the only thing that people have really managed to do with fermions and optical lattices is simply to realize the Mott-insulator state. They haven't even got as far as seeing the antiferromagnetic transition. And the reasons for that, they're discussed in some detail by my colleague Brian DeMarco and one of his students in a recent paper here.
But just looking at the configuration of atoms in an optical lattice, how do they say it's a superconducting?
Oh, that's a very, very good question, yes. How would one see superconductivity? That is actually a rather nasty question. And one can ask two questions. First of all, how would you know that the system was Cooper-paired, that is, it had off-diagonal long-range order? Secondly, how would you know that it's phenomenologically superconducting? And surprisingly, I think the second question is probably easier to answer than the first. In other words, it would not be that difficult to apply some kind of chemical potential gradient and see if you've got something corresponding to what, in the case of helium, would be superflow there. It would be more difficult to to actually see directly the onset of Cooper pairing. There are ways of doing it, but they involve rather delicate correlation measurements between atoms coming out in different opposite directions and so forth. But so far, as you see, we're not even one step on the road to that, in effect. But people are working pretty hard on this, and I wouldn't be surprised if we don't get some experimental results within the next 5 years or so, which will tell us. Okay, I was actually asked to talk just briefly about dipole interactions. Again, I think something's probably missing here, but it turns out that dipolar interactions can actually be competitive with the standard contact interaction, the delta function interaction I wrote down before. This is not the case for alkali atoms. I had actually an order of magnitude for the dipole interaction in here, and what we find is that the dipole interaction is proportional to some quantity G, which has the same dimensions as U0 in our contact interaction expression. For the alkalis, the ratio of G to U is always small compared to 1. However, if we take dysprosium isotopes, then it has a very large spin, P, in the ground state, so that gives a G over U comparable to 1. And in fact, my colleague Brian DeMarco in the last 2 or 3 years has actually cooled down dysprosium to the point where the Bose isotopes were actually Bose condensed, in fact. So, and in that state, certainly the dipole interactions are going to be quite comparable to the contact ones. What does one do with these dipolar interactions? Looks at first sight, at least, as if they're not going to be terribly useful from the point of view of quantum computation. They do have all sorts of interesting theoretical predictions about the phase diagram and so forth. These are not totally unique to this system, actually. I mean, there are other cases involving high nuclear spin, which have been investigated in traditional solids for the last 20 years or so. So these are not qualitatively novel, necessarily, but they're still quite interesting, and no doubt there will be quite a bit more research on them. So let's assume that we have one atom per site, and we are in the Mach limit, where each atom is at least in the original state, we just have one atom sitting on each site and not moving away from it. So the atoms are pretty well solid. Now, rather soon after the experimental implementation of ultra-cold atomic gases in optical lattices, people started to realize that there was one trick which you can use with these systems, which really, as far as I know, has no real analog in any area of condensed matter, traditional condensed matter physics. And that is, you can make very nicely tailored state-specific potentials. That is, potentials which are which act only on an atom which is in a particular hyperfine state. And you can make these different. Analog is a typo there. Should be no real analog in condensed matter physics. Let's consider a superposition of an incident wave given by this expression. And now we're going to have a reflected wave, but the reflected wave is going to have polarization rotated through an angle theta. Okay, and that's relatively easy to obtain with various polarizing crystals and so forth. And apart from that, the reflected wave is going to have the same, it's going to have opposite wave vector and therefore the same frequency. Now, you'll do a relatively straightforward piece of algebra, which shows that is equivalent to a superposition of a right-handedly circularly polarized wave, that is one EX cos omega t plus EY sin omega t, with a particular offset of of its minima and so forth, and also a left-handedly polarized, circularly polarized wave with a different value of the offset here. And so that's a relatively straightforward piece of algebra to get from one to the other. Now, let's consider specifically the specially stable states of rubidium 87, or actually both all these. Sorry. All of these three have the same, have I equals 3/2 in their ground state, so they have basically the same structure of their hyperfine levels. This turns out to have electronic spin, which is purely plus a half. This is the maximum value of MF which you can have for this system, so it must have the maximum value of the electronic spin. This state is a little more complicated. It's 75% mx equals minus a half, and 25% ms equals plus a half. Provided that the detuning is large compared to the, this should be hyperfine Zeeman splitting, then it turns out, this is not immediately obvious, but you can convince yourself this is right, that provided that's true, then basically the system doesn't know about the fine details of the hyperfine structure, and you can work entirely in terms of the eigenstates of MS. In other words, you don't have to worry about the subtle MF degrees of freedom. Now, if you look at those two states in terms of their electronic spin, forgetting about the subtleties of the nuclear spin here, you have your S a half ground state, which has plus a half and minus a half. And then you have the P 3 halves and P a half excited states. And this should actually be, I guess, MJ rather than MS, but it's the sum of the combination of the electronic spin and electronic orbital angular momentum. Now, you see that from conservation of total angular momentum, the effective Hamiltonian which you generate cannot change the total spin. Remember, you're just virtually emitting and absorbing the same photon, and therefore you can't you haven't changed the photon angular, the real photon angular momentum. You can't have changed the electronic spin. So V effective of R, which applies of course to this ground state here, that's diagonal in the MS basis. Secondly, you see that the sigma plus field, that is the right-handedly polarized field, only takes you from here to here, and the sigma minus polarized photon only takes you from here to here. However, that gives you, if I'm polarized below if I'm red detuned with respect to that transition, that gives me a simple red shift. The slight complication in that the sigma plus field will couple the sigma. I think there's something wrong here. No, okay, it's fine. It couples it only there is a typo here. It should be both. The sigma plus field couples ms equals minus a half both to the p 3 halves ms equals plus 1 half state. This one here, I guess. Do I mean that? Sorry. Ms equals minus a half. It goes to this one. Sorry, I'm talking about this arrow here. But it also couples it to the p equals a half, ms equals plus a half. And it'll be red-shifted with respect to this transition, but blue-shifted with respect to this one. So that's an advantage, because what that means is that if I adjust the frequency correctly, I can actually annul any effect of sigma plus on this minus a half state, and conversely sigma minus on this one state here. So as a result of these rather apparently messy considerations, what turns out is that with an appropriate frequency choice, the ms equals plus a half state is sensitive only to sigma plus, giving this potential here. Ms equals minus a half is sensitive only to sigma minus. Now you remember that in fact there's a slight complication, because your original states were in the actual in the real hyperfine coupled situation, these were not. This one is pure MS, but this one is not. So that means you've got to work back to what happens for those states, and what you find is that. I think we've lost a view graph here, but anyway. Executive summary. At the end of the day, what you can do is to make what is essentially a blue potential acting on the F equals 2, MF equals 2 state, and a red potential which acts only on the F equals 1, MF equals minus 1 state. And remember, these are your two computational basis states. So you now have the ability to actually provide trapping potentials which are substantially different for these two computational basis states.
And the distance between these, is that given by theta? Do you move these potentials relative to each other?
That's right. By adjusting theta, that is the angle through which you retroreflected your polarization, you can actually move these potentials relative to one another, and that, of course, is going to be crucial. I'm going to cut this lecture here. I'll talk about glasses next time, and then next Tuesday I'll take this one up again and combine it with these considerations on relative phase and so forth, which, as I say, I don't think are worth a whole 1.5 hours. So.